Hey, what's going on, everybody? My name is Corey, better known as the C-Man, and I want to welcome you to another edition of the C-Man's Cinema Sitdown. Now, for you guys, you'll just get this video whenever it's edited and posted after the first episode is edited and posted. But for me, I had to go to sleep. I was watching Under the Bridge with my mom yesterday. I think we knocked off like 5 episodes in a row, maybe 6. Like that show's got us hooked. But all of a sudden I looked up, I was like, oh crap, it's like 9:30. I better start getting on, you know, my Acolyte stuff. And then a couple things popped up. My sister came home. So by the time I didn't realize the battery wasn't charged. I left my other batteries at home. Complete mess. So by the time I finished episode 1, it was like 11:30. And the C-Man was like, I have to go to sleep. So I have gotten some sleep, and more sleep than I was anticipating. Apparently I forgot to set my alarm, and me and the pup were cuddling until about 9 o'clock this morning. But we are up, we are showered, and we are ready to dive into episode 2 after a pretty solid episode 1. What are we talking about? Why don't you pull up a chair, take a seat? We are getting ready to take a watch and dive in spoiler-filled into The Acolyte, Season 1, Episode 2, Revenge/Justice. And I noticed this yesterday, like after the first episode ended and I was sitting on the screen for a while. I was like, oh man, I like that every episode has like two names, like Lost, Found, Revenge, Justice. And they're kind of, you know, the balancing pieces. I think balance and worlds of two and all of those things, you know, like how that works inside of Star Wars is pretty dope. But as far as the first episode went, I really liked what we got, man. We didn't waste any time getting into the action. And yes, while it's not necessarily your typical Star Wars action, and more solid hand-to-hand combat choreography, it may be a little Matrix-y, being that Carrie Ann Moss was in there, the former Trinity from The Matrix. You know, maybe there was a little bit of that, but seeing her do Matrix-y type things as a Jedi, I think it's freaking dope. And the scene works, right? Like, it's a really solid sequence and opens up the show in a way where you're, like, immediately invested and then immediately confused. Like, to go from May to Osha without knowing that they were twins took a minute, right? And it was one of those that, for me, I was glad that that's what the reveal was, or that it wasn't, like, some sort of trick of some kind for us. Because I think Amanda Seyfried is very likable as Osha. And then to see her play the flip side when she's May is pretty dope. And I think the backstory for her is strong as a character. And I'm really intrigued to see like what happens. Like the thing I love about Leslie Edlin is she knows how to deal with a mystery. So, hey, let's set up this first mystery, right? You see Seyfried kill this person. And then all of a sudden she's on a ship as like a worker and you're like, how did I miss a time jump? Like what just happened? Your first mystery. Oh, she's a twin. You see that in a vision that she has and then they confirm it in the show. And you're like, okay, cool. But now you've got like 8 other questions. And that's the thing that I think Hedlund is really good at, is as you're building and going through a mystery, you got to give the audience wins. And sometimes they've got to be big wins and you need to be able to give a win, but create 2 or 3 more puzzles now where you're like, oh, and that keeps us engaged and invested. That's where I'm at after one episode. I like what we're getting from Jung Jae with, what are they? Oh, dang. Soul. I really dig what they're building with Soul and how he's connected to May and Osha. As well as Carrie Ann Moss's character. And now, like, for them, it's the investigation. Like, same thing. They know the first piece, or at least he believes, you know, what Osha is saying. And now it's, okay, here comes the next piece. And what does this lead to as the Sith start to emerge? So, and then at the end of the episode, you get that, I don't know, like, kind of describing what an Acolyte is, or what an Acolyte does, rather. And like I was saying, the Acolyte is kind of the step right before you become an apprentice. So to see her as an assassin, trying to maybe work her way to be a Sith apprentice, could be a cool run for May. And the dude that was talking to her, the voice, Doug, and just the visual, like, so far away, and you're like, I want to see more. And then, you know, Saber comes at, like, I don't know, one episode in, this thing feels strong. I think it's a good mixture of other elements that we've gotten from shows, right? Like, you have the Star Wars-y stuff that we get from Mando, but I think it's got a little bit more of a serious kind of vibe, similar to Andor. And like, kind of blending these things together, where I think we could be in for something hopefully really dope. So yeah, I'm not gonna waste any more time. I've got to try to sync up my TV and my computer. But let's spin the camera a little bit. There we go. All right, now I'm good. Episode's up for you. I've got it basically queued in both spots here. There we go, in sync. We in sync. Olega. Local Jedi Temple. Who did that? Kid, the Jedi Temple isn't a place for games. Ooh.
Hello. Yep, run along. Oh, wait.
Turn the volume down. That where the would have been the beat switch there. Like, I dig that. I also like that May is always gonna put this mask on when she's in assassin mode, so we know we're watching May and we're not thinking. Also the hair, right? The hair length. Now I don't see the hair. I dig how she's also built two very different vibes for the two characters. Like, I'm a little afraid of her. You know what I mean?
Master Torbin. We have unfinished business.
That's just her move, huh?
Attack me.
I guess it's her
with
right hand.
All of your strength.
She's just taking out, like, a whole bunch of people. Oh, damn. That's some serious Jedi Master stuff right there. He hasn't flinched. That's gonna be a problem for you, May. My thing is, like, does he even realize that she's there? Is he in such a deep meditative state that, like, that force field, like, he wouldn't even know? I feel like he probably is in that kind of, like, deep meditative state. Acolyte!
You could try repolarizing the power couplings.
Boom, boom.
You must be a pilot then.
No, I'm a mechnik.
Wow. I thought that only R2 droids did the outer ship work.
Well, any astromech can do the job, but I'm better company than a droid. And, way more flexible.
I'm sorry, Pip.
Pip is also very flexible.
I said in episode one, I really dig Pip, like, having a stationary droid that, like, is a tool, almost.
I must protest over not restraining the prisoner. She has escaped once before.
You still think she killed Indara?
Indara, there it is.
Even if her sister was alive, May would not have the training to defeat a Jedi Master.
Osha hasn't trained in 6 years.
Right? Osha ain't able to do any of the...
They could be working together.
Don't let fear affect your judgment.
Freaking Yord, man.
She was presumed dead 16 years ago. But I believe she is responsible for Indara's murder.
I'm inclined to agree. There's been another incident. A suspect matching Osha's description broke into a local Jedi temple.
Where?
Olega. She could hardly be in your custody and committing another crime at the same time.
Facts.
Go investigate. Take Osha with you. She could be an asset.
Is that the cause?
Except her connection to the Force ain't that strong anymore. But Mech-Mech, she is useful.
Osha is coming with us. I believe she can help.
Master, Osha is not.
The Jedi agree with me.
Setting course for Olega.
This character's name is outrageous. And then, like, every time he does something, it really does just elicit a, like, Yord.
Hey. Hey. I waited up all night. Where have you been?
Out there risking my life.
Sumei's being herself out in the world.
So did you kill the guy?
I was this close and I couldn't land a single blow.
So you must also be a...
He doesn't have one.
Like, working with her.
He's impenetrable. I need a weapon.
I need you to make me a poison.
Bunta? Really?
I'm running out of time.
You're running out of Jedi. And if you think a sleeping monk is tough, good luck defeating a Wookiee.
I have two Jedi to kill after Torbin. And I will kill one of them without a weapon and please the Master.
I need a drink. Don't you think what we do is so stressful? I do really believe that, though. Everyone has a weakness. The Jedi justify their galactic dominance in the name of peace. And peace...
is a lie, I know.
Every Jedi, he only thinks he's found peace. What he really needs is something only you can give him.
What is this?
Absolution.
Well, he's making the poison right there. It would be good to have a top.
Thank you. It wouldn't bode well for either of us if you told him about this.
Of course.
What is that?
Oh, this is a pip droid. I'm trying to sync him to your ship.
I mean, what is that?
I got this in Corpsec. It was a crazy night with some of my crew. And you hate it.
Do you believe the maze behind the Indara's murder?
It's the only way to explain all of this. You must have survived somehow.
I wanted to save you both.
What happened that night wasn't your fault, Sol.
And I have made peace with what happened on Brando.
That was a lesson you tried to teach me many times, to accept what I'd lost. And I wasn't a very good student.
Perhaps I wasn't a very good teacher.
Coming up on a Lego.
It's tough, man. Tough to, like, have to be, like, a Jedi student while also having to go through grief. Right? Because I'm figuring if she was 8 when she started at the temple, it was probably right after he took her with him.
Welcome to a Lego. We didn't think Coruscant would be interested in our little break-in.
This crime may be connected to another open investigation.
This dude is just... Oh, damn, she's still there? Oh, no, she went back.
Please, walk us through what happened last night.
Someone spotted a hooded intruder and alerted me, but we searched the temple and found nothing.
Before the gatekeeper droids failed, they caught this little scoundrel messing about our portcullis.
Do you remember me, Master Torbin? I know why you took the Mirage Veil. You thought this life would give you the peace you seek, but your past still haunts you.
Did you activate the security droid? Why did you activate it?
She paid me to.
Who paid you to?
Her.
You had a hood on, but it was her.
I would like to speak with Master Torbin, please.
Master Torbin hasn't spoken to anyone in over 10 years.
10 years? Damn.
I offer you a choice. Confess your crime to the Jedi Council, or receive the forgiveness you seek right here, right now, from me.
Oh snap. He is aware.
Face the past, Master Torbin.
Oh, he's starting to bob.
I've been waiting for you.
I want to know exactly what happened. Like, why is she targeting this specific group?
Forgive me.
Damn, he's just gonna take it willingly?
We thought we were doing the right thing.
Are Jedi behind this fire? Took it willingly. This is wild. And it's been 10 years since, right? Like, they're supposed to be like 18. Like, wow. Oh, man. This is what I mean. Like, pulling back the layers of one thing, leading to more layers for us to explore. Here for this. So I gotta look who's doing the scoring, because the scoring has been excellent.
Hey! Step away from the body.
I know what this looks like, but I can explain.
Do not move.
He was poisoned.
How do you know?
She didn't do it. My sights were on her the entire time. I followed her when she broke off. This master was dead when we arrived.
Thank you, Yord.
Yord. Good old Yord. Flip-flopping a lot for me in this episode. Yord. The good old Yord.
It took this poison willingly.
This is Boonta from my home planet.
Boonta.
Boonta is a poison. My sister and I were taught to use it in hunting. If it's distilled, its effects don't last very long, so it had to have come from nearby. Is this the only apothecary in town?
That's why they're there.
That's not our regular guy. I don't know who that guy is.
We secure the perimeter. Jecky stays on lookout, and I will confront this imposter. Stun him, if need be. Then we bring him back to the ship for questioning.
Oh, we skip that, and she just talks to him.
Right.
We can send her in. She can talk to him. We can record and monitor the conversation. That way, we have a lead on May, plus we also get a confession from him. Seems like the most logical.
Get him, Daphne Keen. I gotta figure out what the name of her character is.
We will follow your plan, Padawan.
Padawan.
Giving a civilian a weapon violates 13 precepts.
Osha knows how to use one of these. Are you ready?
Jecky Lon.
Of course.
Yord, Jecky, Osha, Soul. I get all these names eventually. Get a lot thrown at us.
Hello?
Hello.
Hi.
She's not very good at impersonating May.
Hi, you alright?
This guy probably already can tell.
I wanted to see you.
See me?
Should have thought this through more.
Are you okay? Did the poison work?
That's it, that's all we need.
Let's pull her out.
Wait!
You're acting so strange.
Wait, you killed Torbin without the poison. He will be so pleased.
Well, this guy is not as smart as I thought he was.
No, I used it. I just wanted to thank you.
Now I think he's putting two and two together.
You look exactly like her.
Whoa, wait. Hold on.
Back away. Where's May?
Hold on.
We know you supplied May with the poison that killed Master Torbin. We have your confession.
That isn't my thing. This is her. I didn't know what she was going to do with that stuff.
If you cooperate, we will consider letting you go with a warning.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, sir. Please don't do the memory wipe thing or whatever it is.
What is your relationship to May?
I'm just her supplier. Started out gun running for the huts. Now I supply people like her with what they need for the right price.
Well, maybe you could
I feel, yeah, I was gonna say, he's not telling the truth.
I thought he was with you.
You said he
may have a master.
Listen, I have no idea what's going on with that girl. All I know is that she wants revenge on four Jedi. If you want to get to her, she'll be back here tonight.
Yord, secure the perimeter. Jecky, get to the ship. You're coming with me.
Interesting. But I do love these mystery, like, crime investigation vibes.
I have a bad feeling about this.
What if this guy's lying?
Yord, stick to the plan.
Do not interfere.
I will confront her.
I must face her alone.
We both knew this is where this trip was headed.
I didn't know you were still so angry.
She killed my family. She destroyed my life.
Let it go.
You are not my master.
It's hard to let it go, man.
I deserve justice.
You want revenge. Look what revenge has done to your sister.
Thugs.
I couldn't save her when you were children. Let me try now.
She wants to kill four Jedi stationed on Brendok 16 years ago. Indara, Torbin, Kelnaka, and you.
Well, so she knows the four.
Have faith in me, and have faith in me.
Like, I need this backstory episode. When are we gonna get it? Maybe episode 4. Confirmed.
I see her.
She's approaching.
Headed your way.
Hey!
Waste no time.
You survived. You killed Indara and Torbin.
Ooh, a warning shot. Loves to do that reveal. I love when you can see, like, the masters just being masters. Like, you're good, but you're not at this level where it looks just so easy for him.
You attack me without a weapon.
Sith stuff.
Why?
Ooh, swing and a miss. Jung Jae's killing it, though. Dude, the nonchalantness is so good. And he stripped her of all of them? Yo, this guy.
You have misunderstood the Jedi arts. Your master has failed you. Who trained you?
Watching.
What's going on, Yord?
Sol is trying to find out who trained May.
I'll turn on his comms.
Love how easy he makes it look. Got her.
I see your master has taken great pains to hide his identity. Even from you. You couldn't tell me who he is even if you wanted to.
Get out of my head, Jedi.
The emotion, man. Oh.
Even after all this time, your thoughts still go to your sister.
My sister is dead!
Osha is alive.
May doesn't know that Osha's alive?
You lie!
Nice, Yord. Yord!
He speaks the truth.
He didn't know? Wow, that's kind of wild. Yord! Is waiting to get involved. Not letting you get away, girly.
In the name of the Galactic Son of the Republic.
Jecky.
Let your weapons down and surrender.
You got caught. She gotta try to get away though. Oh, damn. That was way more powerful than I thought that move would be. I didn't know that that's what she would do, but, like, whatever she was gonna do with the sand to create, like, a diversion. Didn't expect that one. It's fairly impressive.
I've lost visual. I'm turning back around.
Copy that. We are headed to the city gates. We have to stop May before she escapes from Olega.
She's looking. Oh, my. It's gonna let Osha find her. It's gotta be where we end up. Oh yeah, Osha did find her. Oh snap.
Oshi?
Oh! Warning shower, did she just miss? That rusty? I think she missed on purpose. Made it look like she was trying. Sol knows. It's very wise.
I have convened a small council to discuss next steps. We are awaiting your arrival.
With respect, we don't have time for talks, Master Vanestra.
Your old Padawan going rogue was one thing, but now a trained outsider is responsible. We need to strategize.
But we know where she's going next. We must move.
We don't make decisions like this without meaningful discussion, Sol.
Frustrations of the Jedi. Like, the in-the-moment investigator, warrior mode, like, that stuff gotta be frustrating, man. I love how sketchy this dude is. Oh! Oh! Easy.
You sold me out to the Jedi. They're right up there. I should kill you for betraying me like this.
I can get us out of this city.
And go where?
Kofar. Or
relaxing forest retreat in the Outer Rim where the Wookiee Jedi lives.
Oh, snap.
You found Kilmaka.
Oh, I can't wait to get Wookiee Jedi.
He's gone. Come on. Come on.
Kofar. Kind of got, like, Kashyyyk vibes as far as being woodland-y. We're lost. Can't believe I let you tuck me into coming here. The crashed ship. I bet there's a hyperdrive we can strip for parts. What? Yeah, I was gonna say, what does it say? How should I know? Yes, Wookiee! Oh, Wookiee Jedi, yes! Oh, I'm so here for a Wookiee Jedi. Well done, Leslie Headland. That's another rock solid episode. Hold on, this is about my car. And my car's back in working order, baby. Oh wait, I should. I still need these, but we gotta go back. Sorry, had to make sure that the car was back in working order. Get to go pick it up today. Get to go back to being a normal person. Makes me very happy, even though it's not a cheap fix. Probably better than going to buy a used car, so I get to at least keep the one I have. Anyway, episode 2 of The Acolyte. I'm really digging what Leslie Headland's doing, man. Like I said, for me, if you're gonna take this approach, I want there to be reveals and more questions every episode. And I think the one thing that Headland has done very well from episode 1 to episode 2 and leading into episode 3 is the way the episodes are ending. You're immediately like, wait, no, I want more, right? Like seeing her master and the little speech he gives her about, you know, like needing to kill without a weapon. You're immediately like, oh man, like we're getting into it. Like we're getting, I almost feel like at times we're getting things we don't think that we'll get at these certain points, but in getting them, you have more questions. And then this episode, I love that you don't go back to him, right? Like you mention him several times, but not directly going back and kind of starting to build a little bit more for May as far as where she's coming from, who she's working with, the fact that she's targeting 4 Jedi, the fact that Osha knows the 4 Jedi that she's targeting. Like that's the thing that I am becoming more and more intrigued by is how big of a relationship did the Jedi have to that, if it was a village or whatever it was, and her family in particular, where Osha doesn't know that May is alive, and May, being the one that we thought was dead coming from Osha's perspective and Sol's perspective and Idara's perspective, she has no idea that Osha's alive, which is kind of wild. So it's like, who was where? How did she get out if she's the one that started the fire? And in like, why does she want revenge, right? And Sol mentions that to May, too, or to Osha, too, right? Like, you want revenge. Like, you gotta sit this one out, right? Like, you're still attached to the emotions of things. Well, I guess she wants revenge on May because she thinks May set the fire. But why does May want revenge on the Jedi, right? And then the look at justice from the two perspectives. Like, that's what I love, like, Lost and Found, not knowing that May was alive and then finding May, to here where you're really diving into the revenge for both characters. And Osha's is obviously a bit new, but knowing that May is alive, she's pissed. May killed her whole family. What is the thing that's making May tick? And that's where I think Headland is doing a really good job in revealing things to us that are pulling us into the story and into these characters, but also leaving us in places where we're like, wait, no, don't end here. I have more questions. I need more answers. And it's what I think is really interesting with the show is it's averaging about you know, with all of the credits, 38, but by the time the credits kick in, you're right about at a half hour with these episodes, like right on about the 30-minute mark. And I remember, like, in when Mando started shrinking in size in you know, episode length, you just kind of felt like there was so much missing. And again, this is where I think I said this as soon as Hedlund was given this. I'm like, having the Russian doll background is going to be very beneficial because Hedlund understands how to construct an episode and how to construct an episode that's short but impactful. Like, there's a lot that happens in these 30-minute episodes, and you're getting a lot to take away where you're getting satisfaction, you're getting payoffs, but you're also getting more questions and teeing up things. Like, I love getting the look at Koshar and then getting to see, you know, our Wookiee. Where? Come on. Like, our Wookiee Jedi is... I like that he's got the hair pulled back, man. Like, teeing into all of these things and knowing where they're going. Like, something about a Wookiee Jedi. Every time it pops up in the animated stuff, I just get super excited. So, like, anytime, you know, in live action too. So, I love seeing those types of things. But that, you know, that's just one of those, like, oh, yes, we're going to get Wookiee stuff. Which, like, that kind of, for me, plays to the badassery of the show, too. Where it's, like, the action sequences. I love that episode one dropped it right at the start. Then you build story. Episode two, keep building that story. And then drop the action in the middle. And, I mean, everything that we get with the two of them, I thought was really, really good. Like, let's go, where are we? Come on back to the showdown in the streets of the town that we're in. Is this a Lego? One of those spots, but like... No, yeah, there's... Weird. I love how she loves that reveal. And again, I really am impressed with how Senberg is building two very different characters, but when they saw each other, it was like almost that they were the same person. Like, you can see how they're twins as well. But like, I tell you, the choreo is good. And my favorite about this whole sequence is just Jung Jae, like, casual, trying to piece together, like, while he's fighting, he's still working on the investigative aspects. Like, why would you try to fight me without a weapon, right? Like, you clearly are been force trained. You know that I've got a lightsaber. She goes for it. And, like, so why are you attacking me without the weapon? I think it's because Sol knows things about the Sith. And I feel like he's going there already. Without necessarily any of the other Jedi going there yet. But and then to strip her of almost all of her knives. I like that she has one up her sleeve.
Your master has failed you. Tell me, who trained you?
Who's trained you? But it's like, oh gosh, yeah, man. Like, I really dig. One, the choreography there, I think, is super tight. But two, like, again, just exploring these characters in ways where it's like you can see where Sol is coming from, what Sol is getting after, how he's working. And I love how you can see the difference in the skill level, right? Like, all right, you got Idara in a scenario where cleverness got in the way, right? Like, Idara was, I'm gonna not let you kill a civilian while I'm borderline distraction because he just popped up, but because her now like focus is over here, you can get off the kill shot. Okay. You know, the second guy literally hasn't spoken since whatever this event was that happened 10 years ago, or at least I would assume, because I feel like they said she was 8 when they found her, and that was like 10 years ago. I could be wrong. Maybe I'm blending episode things together. But if that's what's the case, right, like, not much of a showdown there. She doesn't really have to throw down with a master. And again, like, Carrion Moss, you got Idara caught off guard. Second dude, he was just willing to do it because he clearly has had issue, like, didn't want to abandon the Jedi, but clearly had issue with whatever happened back then, and has been in this, like, meditative state for 10 years, which is just crazy. So then when you get to Sol, who has the drop on her, you see the difference in the skill level. Like, yes, Mei's very good, But even being very good, the nonchalant movements and just how easy Sol makes it look as he fights her, like... But, like, it's just, I love everything that Jung Jae is doing character-wise, from performance to handling the action really, really well. And again, I like that you put this toward the end of the episode, right? Like, keep building the story. And I think what you're building from Mei's character perspective, right? Like, introducing the dude who's helping her. Where is he in the rankings? Like, how does he connect, right? That's one of those things with, like, the Sith. What we have gotten, you know, it's the rule of two. There's never more than two of them. And they're always doing things seemingly outside of Palpatine, who's using the entire Galactic Senate. But, like, you know, you don't see them kind of necessarily interacting with, like, oh, yeah, let me get you some posts. So, like, what are the inner workings of different people that they work with? Is he part of a larger crew? Is he a high outside hire, right? Like, what's his deal? How does he know Mei? And how far back does he go with Mei? Like, I like that you're exploring all these things and then really getting into the investigative stuff. Like, I'm digging everything that the Jedi are doing. Like, getting to see the Jedi do investigative stuff. Like, the stuff that we would get with Obi-Wan and Anakin in the animated series, right? Like, there are times where that show is literally them just going to planets, asking questions, things pop up, dealing with the thing that pops up in real time, and then continuing on in whatever you're investigating. Why are you so wet? Go back up, buddy. Sit. Sit. Chill. No paw. I'm. You see, I'm recording. You know this. Chill. No more. Why are you wet? Like, what are we doing outside that we're so wet? Can you go lay down, please? You also smell now. Thank you. You're a good boy. I love you. But, like, I don't know, gotta deal with that. Anyway, what was I saying? Oh, yeah, like, the investigative aspects. Like, while Sol has pretty much been the front center lead in these things, I love that you get a character like Yord. I gotta give props to Charlie Barnett. He's just... The performance that he's giving us is just one of those things where you're like... You almost feel like Yord... is a little, like... too good, right? Like, you know, like, he's got, like, a little bit of an arrogance to the way he carries himself. So, like, a lot of times when he interjects or says things in the first half and even at the end, it's like second half of last episode, you're just like, Yord, like, freaking Yord. But then you get these moments where Yord shows up in big ways and is helpful, and you're just like, all right, Yord, like, come on, man. Like, Barnett's doing a really good job of crafting a character that you can love and not love at the same time, right? Like, he's your kind of back and forth. Daphne Keene, I'm really digging her as Jecky. Like, every time she has input, you can tell that she's Master Sol's Padawan, right? Like, she's very smart, very quick, and very perceptive. I like the way that she's seeing things and how things are unfolding. And when Yord presents the most, you know, straightforward solution, let's just go down there. I'll go down there, zap him, then we interrogate him, do whatever we got to do to get the information. Jecky's like, okay, that might be the most obvious move, but this is the most logical one. Like, if he's working with Mei, we have someone who looks exactly like Mei. And if Osha goes down there and he doesn't recognize her, okay, then maybe he's not working with Mei. Question however you will. The one thing I think all of them should have done is prepped her better. Her acting job was terrible. Like, I would have never given up any of the information that dude gave up. Because he seemed suspect from her from the jump. And then as soon as he gave up the important things where the Jedi are going to come running, he's like, oh yeah, no, you'd look just like her. Not sure why he would say the things he would say there, considering that you know there are Jedi in town. But maybe he's just not too smart. He doesn't necessarily give off those vibes. And again, what's his deal? How connected is he to what's going on with the Sith? And then, like, the thing I really dig when you get to the end of the episode is, one, despite seeming to be completely outmatched when she gets to Sol, Mei still got some cleverness to her. That move with all the dust really worked quite well. Got her away. I like that you get the showdown with her and Osha. And I love that Senberg is doing such a great job of presenting two very different characters. But like the way that like line went, you know, like always as one, but born as two, like they are kind of like the two sides of a coin almost, right? Where they are the same person. And you see that, you get that vibe finally from May when she's staring down Osha at the end, like that little exchange, you're like, okay, now I can see the twin vibes where there definitely are similarities to these characters. They can be the same person, even on the, if they're on the opposing sides of each other. And just in that like one shot, you kind of get all of that. And Semberg is just crushing it performance wise. And I love that you have someone like May who was Soul's Padawan, and we have his current Padawan who's very clever. You'd imagine that skill set wise, when you're seeing what May is doing, that Osha should probably be fairly good when it comes to combat and all the things she would have been learning for the, you know. Are we serious? Can we, like. Wait, where, what was I talking about? This freaking dog, man. Senberg. Talking about a manless Senberg and the kind of two sides of a coin. I love how we've had so much. Like, it's one of these where I was almost saying to myself while I was watching the episode, like, we haven't gotten these two on screen, even though it feels like they have, because you've had the interactions with the younger selves, and kind of however that twin connection thing is working with Osha. So when you finally do, like, to this point, through two episodes, they're so different. And then the fact that Hedlund, in basically just one setup, can give you a vibe that brings you to a point where, oh my gosh, they finally do see each other, and you can see like so many things going through both of their faces, but like they are the same, they can be the same character. And I the way that she kind of creates that two sides of a coin vibe even stronger in just that one shot is, I just really dug it. But Senberg is doing an excellent job where, like, even in that shot where it's like you finally see that similarity where both of their faces go to this kind of same place, there's also so many layered emotions behind it, right? Like, for Osha, there's the, she is alive. Oh my God, that's my sister. Same with May, but then they're also on opposing sides from each other. So there's that, like, oh man. And again, I'm fascinated to see what the full perspective is from both of them, because they clearly are both missing pieces, right? Like, the fact that neither of them knew the other was alive is wild and fascinating and creates like a bunch of interesting layers. But yeah, I think two episodes in, Hedlund is creating something that is giving us lots, right? Like, we're I think it feels like we're getting a ton of content packed into 30 minutes, but it doesn't feel overstuffed, and it just keeps pulling me in more and more. And then you get to the end of the episode, and rather than going back to her master again, it's, oh, you know what? We're stuck in this city, town, place now, because there are Jedi everywhere. Homeboy's gonna have to help get me out, and his way out is, well, I can get us to this place where your Wookiee Jedi is. And I it was funny because when they came up on, I was like, oh man, this has got like vibes of Kashyyyk, thinking that maybe there'd be other Wookiees there. Clearly not, but you could understand why a Wookiee would go hide out here or crash. I guess if he crash landed, I guess he didn't pick to go here, but the vibe seems very suitable for a Wookiee. So you can understand why maybe he's been here for as long as he has or thrived. Either way, I love that you get just such a unique, and that's one of the other things I always love about Star Wars, is when we go to these different places, the unique vibes you get at the different places you go to, so that just by visual, you can identify, like, these places are different from each other, and just the whole vibe of the setup and the set design around Koshar is great. But then I love, like, you got these two people who are just scavengers, and they're like, oh man, it's a Wookiee, oh man, he can do force type things, like, let's get up out of here, G. But in the same way where, like, the end of last episode, you reveal our Sith character, now you're revealing the next target for May, and I'm just like, I have so many questions, right? Like, why is he hiding out here? How long has he been here? What's his deal? Like, I don't know. I just think the show is doing really a really good job of pulling me in story-wise. And then I think the Star Wars-y things that we get here and there throughout are really solid. But I am so invested in this investigation and where it's going. Because I think much like Jung Jae's soul is doing investigations while he's fighting, my brain is like, okay, well, if these are the things we're building in these ways that could lead to these things, what does that then have as a trickle-down effect to the overall universe and where we could go with this story moving forward? And I just think we're in a really interesting space, and I can't wait to see what we get next week. But yeah, two episodes in. A really solid two-episode premiere. I needed a nap or a full-on sleep in between episodes because it got a little late for me because I was running behind. Thank you, Under the Bridge. Me and my mom probably gonna finish that today. But like, I feel like I've got a really solid base. I've got new characters that I'm very interested in. I love that there is no connection to the Skywalkers and no connection to the things that we typically hang out in the Star Wars world. And we can develop these new characters that we're not familiar with in ways where I'm intrigued with everybody, right? Like, I'm intrigued with Osha. I'm intrigued with Mei. I'm intrigued with Sol. Yord and Jecky are great little side characters where it's like, when they get more, I'm here for it. I'm intrigued by who the targets are, what's going on in the overall story. Like, I'm just fully invested two episodes in, and that makes me very happy as a Star Wars fan. And like I said, I think Hedlund has been very strategic, right? Like, hey, let's show you what we got right out the gate. Boom. Start at episode one. Here's a cool, fun action sequence for you. Then we're going to dive into the fact that this is going to be a mystery, and this is going to be an investigative piece where we're trying to figure out this puzzle. And as we're going, that story is getting us invested, and then boom, here's another dope action set piece. Yes, it's not necessarily your typical Star Wars Jedi action. We're not doing a lot of lightsaber work. We've gotten a little bit. That's fine. You know, like, I want to be able to build two big moments and fun things like that. And we've seen in the trailers, we're going to see lots of lightsabers. And I think Koshar is going to be that spot where maybe we do see her master show up, or somebody with a red lightsaber, and you've got a bunch of Jedi on this, like, foresty planet. I think that's what it was in the trailer. So, like, that stuff's coming. But what you're showing me is that the action is well choreographed, it's well executed, and you sit there and you go, dope. And I understand the reasoning to why we aren't necessarily getting right to the lightsaber stuff, because Mei's master wants her to kill one of these Jedi without a weapon, and she doesn't have a lightsaber. So having to work the way that she's working makes sense, and the Jedi responding in suit also makes sense. They're not out there looking to kill. Like, I'm pretty sure Dara could have whipped her lightsaber out, cut her down right away. Same with Sol. But they don't want to. That's not what their nature is. So if you're not going to come at me with a weapon as the Jedi, you feel pretty secure in, like, there's nothing that you're going to do as a master, at least. You're not going to kill me if you don't have a lightsaber. And again, the spots that Mei has succeeded, cleverness in a distraction mode to make a Jedi do something a Jedi would do, save a person, like an innocent person. Two, guy didn't want to fight, and now you finally get shown up, you see that difference. And I think where you're going from the action standpoints is building in good ways, just as the story is building in good ways. So yeah, two episodes in, premiere week of The Acolyte, I am extremely happy. I really enjoyed both of these episodes quite a bit, and like I said, I'm invested in the mystery and the characters, and that's really what you ultimately want when you're doing things like this. So I'm going to shut up. I'll flip it over to you guys. What did you think of episode 2, Revenge/Justice? Who's getting revenge? Whose revenge is justified? Do we know? What things are you asking and questions do you have coming out of this episode? What's working? What's not? Do you like the action? Do you not like the action? Does it feel Star Wars-y enough for you? Is it building in a way where you're invested and you feel like there could be a big pop? What's working? What's not? Good, bad, indifferent on episode 2, but overall for the premiere week 1 and 2, anything you got, put it down below in the comment section. Look forward to talking to you down there. As always, if you enjoyed this video, please give me a thumbs up. And if you're new, you want to come hang out with the C-Man anytime we're talking movies, TV, trailer, reactions, you want to be here for our week-by-week watch-alongs and mini breakdowns, you just dig the vibe, you want to show a little love and support, come join C-Maniac Nation. Super easy. Jump over there. Hit the subscribe button. Hit that little bell if you want those alerts. And until next time, for the C-Man's Cinema, sit down. I've been the C-Man. I'm the sound and no. Peace. Hey, what's up, C-Maniac Nation? Winter Ken here, where we grow out our roots and our beard, letting you know that you can see some new C-Man videos right up here and right down here. And if you want all those videos and show that man a little love and support, come join C-Maniac Nation right over there, and the C-Man will catch you on the next one.